بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد الصادق الوعد الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه من تبعهم بإحسان ودعا بدعوتهم إلى يوم الدين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما وعملا يا رب العالمين أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته As always, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has gathered us here today to listen to the words of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept His gathering of ours and make it a means of success for us in this life and in the life hereafter, inshaAllah. So as we all know, dear brothers, going straight into it, inshaAllah, this time tomorrow, maybe, and I think most likely we'll be preparing for Taraweeh and Ramadan, inshaAllah, will enter either tomorrow or maybe Monday. Now, I just want to spend, inshaAllah, the next few moments, maybe half an hour, maybe more, let's see, reflecting on how we can take full benefit, inshaAllah, from Ramadan. Now, Ramadan, the word itself, dear brothers, gives us a very, very, you know, important message. The word itself, Ramadan. The word itself, Ramadan, comes from the root words Ramadan. In Arabic, Ramadan. Now, Ramadan in Arabic means to burn, right? To burn. And Imam Al-Qurtubi rahimahullah ta'ala, in his tafsir, he mentions that the reason why Ramadan is called Ramadan because this is an opportunity to burn away your sins, right? To burn away your sins. This is why Ramadan is called Ramadan. So, just from the, we don't even need to go into, you know, the ahadith. Obviously, the ahadith give it more virtue. There is more, you know, there's more power behind Ramadan. But just from the word itself, subhanAllah, it gives us an important message that this is an opportunity for us to burn away our sins. Right? We will be burning in the heat, but we need to remember that at the same time we are burning away our sins. Right? Now, what is the purpose of Ramadan? The purpose of Ramadan is to do two things. Number one, to gain a connection with the Quran. And number two, to gain taqwa. In Ramadan, we do two very important acts of worship. Number one is that we do a lot of tilawa of the Quran. And this is the hikmah behind Taraweeh, where the Quran is being recited. Many, many places, this masjid, many masajid around the UK, around the world, they go through the entire Quran, right? Why do they do this? Because this is a message for us. That just like we are going through the journey of the Quran in this month, this should be your purpose throughout your entire life as well. Wherein you are constantly reading the Quran. You see, it is like a training course. Wherein day in, day out, we are used to listening to the Quran. And when Ramadan comes to an end, what happens? Our ears are so used to listening to the Quran. Our tongues are so used to reciting the Quran. Our eyes are so used to looking at the Mus'haf. That after Ramadan, if we spend it in the correct way, what happens? All of these limbs will be yearning for the Quran. Our ears will be yearning to listen to the Quran. Our tongues will be yearning to recite the Quran. And our eyes will not feel comfort unless we, you know, we have a glance at the Mus'haf. This is the beauty of Ramadan. So Ramadan is a month, you know, wherein Allah in the Quran, He mentions that شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصمه. Allah says that the month of Ramadan is the month in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the quality of this Quran. The quality of this Quran is that it is a guidance. And there are clear proofs in the Quran for those people who are rejecting the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For those people who are turning away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what Ramadan is about. Thereafter, so Allah declares that this is the month of the Quran. Thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. Whosoever witnesses this month, then let him fast. So now there is a direct connection. One may ask that why is Allah making a connection here between Quran and Siyam, fasting? What is the connection? Allah says that this is the month of the Quran, and He also says this is the month of fasting. What is the connection? The connection is that when we recite the Quran, we are softening our heart. We are softening our heart. What do I mean by this? That the entire year we spend disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, going away from the mercy of Allah. The entire year we spend disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we do this, dear brothers, we harden the heart. This heart, it becomes hard. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many places in the Quran talks about the evil nature of a heart which has become hard due to sin. We all know the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when the son of Adam commits a sin, then there is a small black dot that engulfs his heart, that goes onto the heart. When you indulge in more sin, then another small black dot will come onto the heart. And this will continue happening. If you do not do tawbah, if you do not do istighfar, seek forgiveness in Allah, this will continue happening until the entire heart will become dark. And this is the definition of a hard heart. But what's the big deal? Why do we need to worry if this heart has become hard? Allah in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, He says that He talks about the Mushrikeen and the Yahud. He says, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ فَهِيَ كَالْحِجَارَةِ أَوْ أَشَدُّ قَسْوَةً. Allah says that your hearts have become hard, and they have become so hard that they are more harder than stone. They are more harder than stone. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He proves that stone sometimes can be softer than hearts. Listen to this. Allah says, so فَهِيَ كَالْحِجَارَةِ أَوْ أَشَدُّ قَسْوَةً وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْحِجَارَةِ لَمَا يَتَفَجَّرُ مِنْهُ الْأَنْهَارُ. There are some types of stone which you will find in the river. There are rivers gushing from this stone. وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَشَّقَّقُ فَيَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ الْمَاءُ. There are other stones which actually split open, and there will be water gushing forth from this. Hot springs gushing forth from this. وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَهْبِطُ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. There are other types of stones which descend from the mountains out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now why is Allah talking about the nature of stones here? In the beginning He talks about the heart, and now suddenly He talks about stones. What is the connection? The connection is, Allah is telling us in this verse that even stones open up. Even stones open up. They are of benefit. That your hearts have become so hard that they are not ready to open up to the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So dear brothers, this entire year, if we analyze and we just do a quick recap of the entire year from last Ramadan to this Ramadan, we will see that so many occasions we have, abandoned the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So many occasions we have disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only Allah knows how far away we have gone from the mercy of Allah. Only Allah knows. Now Allah is giving us a gift. Allah is giving us another opportunity. This opportunity wherein we will regain this connection with Allah. We will come closer to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I was saying that the connection between the Quran and fasting is that the Quran, when we recite it, when we ponder over it, when we educate ourselves with regards to the message of the Quran, the nature of it is that it softens the heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another verse of the Quran, He mentions that إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. These are opening verses of Surah Al-Anfal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions that the believers are only those who, when they hear the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the dhikr of Allah, their hearts start shaking. Their hearts start shaking. Now you need to ask yourself a question, and I need to ask myself a question, that when we hear the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the remembrance of Allah, what is our reaction? What is our reaction? Do our hearts tremble out of the fear of Allah? And then Allah says, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. That when His verses are recited upon them, then it increases them in iman. It increases them in iman. Their iman becomes stronger. Again, we need to ask ourselves a question, that when we listen to the Quran, are we even paying attention? When we listen to the Quran, what effect does it have in our hearts? Does our iman feel stronger? This is the hikmah, dear brothers, behind our five salah. Our five salah, you know, I always say that if it was the case that we understood the Quran the way it should be understood, if we pondered over the Quran, then there will be no need for these lectures. There will be no need for these reminders. Because the Quran is sufficient as a reminder. Right? But the problem is, the reason why we need to have these gatherings is because we fail to benefit from our salah the way we should benefit from it. The five times salah, we are constantly reminding ourselves of our maker. We are constantly reminding ourselves of our purpose in this life. We are constantly reminding ourselves that no matter how high a position you may have, you will be accountable for Allah before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter where you go, what you do, how much money you have, every penny that you earn, you'll be questioned about it. The higher the status, the more difficult the accountability. So this is a month, dear brothers, where we have to ponder that what is the state of my heart? Our hearts, dear brothers, have become so hard that when we are in salah, we think about dunya. When we are in dunya, we think about dunya. When we are in the masjid, we think about dunya. And because we are constantly, you know, indulging in this, shaitan is pulling us one way, our nafs is pulling us the other way, this dunya is pulling us the other way. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the call is being made towards Him five times a day. And subhanallah, many of us don't answer this call. Many of us don't answer this call. We come to the masjid, you know, our phones are always on. We come to the masjid, our minds always in the dunya that I need to do this, I need to do that, I need to do this. The whole purpose of jama'ah, praying in jama'ah, being so important. Why is it so important? Because Allah wants us to cut off from the dunya. Allah wants us to cut off from the dunya. That you are coming into my house, you are standing before me, I want you to focus only on me. Right? So dear brothers, Ramadan is coming. Now Allah has given us two acts of worship which has given us importance. First one being reciting the Quran. So when we recite the Quran, our hard heart becomes soft. It softens. And why is this important, dear brothers? Not only because our iman will become stronger and we will change our ways, but more importantly for the second act of worship, which is fasting. Why do I say this? Though what is the purpose of fasting? Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامِ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The objective of fasting is to gain taqwa. The objective of fasting is to gain taqwa. Now again, there's still no connection. What is the connection? Soft heart, okay, Quran, soft, you know, softening the heart. You know, fasting being a means of taqwa. How does it relate? Allah is giving us a very, very important message in these verses. We need to read between the lines, right? What is this message? Allah is telling us that you will never ever attain taqwa unless you soften your heart, right? You can fast, but if you don't, if this heart is not soft before we enter Ramadan, then we can be fasting day in, day out, and it have no effect on us. And this is why in one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he mentions that مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. That whosoever does not abandon false speech and acting upon it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in no need of him abandoning his food and his drink. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there are certain people that the only thing that they will achieve out of fasting will be thirst and hunger. Nothing else. Normally, we should be achieving taqwa. We should be achieving the forgiveness of Allah, the mercy of Allah. We should be achieving all of these things. But there will be certain people, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that there will be certain people that the only thing they will achieve is abandoning food and drink, nothing else. Allahu Akbar. Why? Because they spend the entire day swearing. They spend the entire day backbiting, abusing people, lying, using this tongue in the wrong way, using these limbs that Allah has given you as a blessing in the wrong way. And because of this, Ramadan, how many Ramadans have gone, subhanAllah, in our lives? You know, the people sitting here, you know, various ages, some people, so many Ramadan has gone past. What effect has it had in your life? This is the question. And if you see that it has had hardly any effect in our life, it's because of this, that we are not benefiting from fasting. And the reason why we're not benefiting from fasting, because we don't prepare for it. Obviously, it's kind of late now, you know, subhanAllah, to prepare for Ramadan, only literally 24 hours left, right? But still, you know, it's never late. Wallahi, it's never late. You make the intention tomorrow that, you know, I want to prepare for Ramadan, and you spend that day in ibadah, you spend that day reciting the Quran, educating yourself, seeking knowledge, then even that slightest, you know, bit of preparation that you did will have an effect on your Ramadan.
Sure.
Right? So this is the connection between fasting and recitation of the Quran. Taqwa will never ever be welcomed by a hard heart. It's like when you go to an abandoned house, a house that has no wallpapers, has no furniture, has no carpet. Does anyone feel like staying there? It has a, you know, very bad smell because it hasn't been, you know, there's no one living there. No one feels like staying there. There'll be rats running around, there'll be cobwebs, there'll be all sorts. You know, broken stuff everywhere. It's completely abandoned. No one, we will never say to our guests, you know, come here and stay here. Never ever. We will never go and live there. Same thing with taqwa. Just like when we see a beautiful house which has beautiful wallpaper, beautiful furniture, beautiful carpet, we feel like staying there, we don't feel like leaving our homes. Because our homes are like this, we have beautified them. Taqwa is the same thing, dear brothers. Taqwa needs a house, and the house of taqwa is the heart. If we do not adorn this heart, taqwa will never ever enter here. Taqwa will never ever be welcomed in our hearts. And this is why, you know, the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wherein he says that, O Allah, grant us the ability to love iman. Habbib ilayna al-iman. And then Allah says, وَزَيِّنْهُ فِي قُلُوبِنَا. Allah says, adorn iman in our hearts. Adorn iman in our hearts. What does this mean? That when you do the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, any act of worship, we are adorning our hearts, we are beautifying our hearts. For what? For a guest called taqwa. When taqwa enters the heart, dear brothers, this is when we can change our lives. This is the only way we can achieve success in this life and in the life hereafter. And what is taqwa? Taqwa means al-khawfu min al-jaleel, wal-amalu bil-tanzeel, wal-isti'dadu li-yawm al-raheem. Three things. Ali radiallahu anhu, he says this. He says, al-khawfu min al-jaleel, fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty. والعمل بالتنزيل, acting upon the revelation, i.e. the Quran. والاستعداد ليوم الرحيل, and preparing for the day of travel, i.e. preparing for the day of Qiyamah. This is in a nutshell what taqwa is. When you have these three qualities, you will see that when you feel like sinning, you will not sin. Yes, there'll be a red light there. Just like when you're, you know, going on a highway, there's a red light, you stop. Who is there to stop you? It's 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the night. There's cameras there. Taqwa is the same concept. That when you have taqwa in your heart, when shaitan invites you to sin, and you feel like sinning, your soul is dragging you towards that sin, taqwa will come in and save you. And you know, even the word taqwa itself comes from waqa, waqi, wiqaya. Waqa, yaqi, wiqaya means to put a barrier between you and something else. So when we have taqwa, we are placing a wall, a barrier. You know, like you have that wall in Palestine, that big wall that no one could ever cross. Huge, and it's very thick. This type of a wall, this is what we're doing. And the thickness of this wall will vary based on how much amal we do. Right? So dear brothers, Ramadan is coming. Message today is, we need to prepare for Ramadan as much as we can in the next day or so. And when Ramadan comes, we need to benefit from Ramadan as much as possible. How are we going to do this? We need to think about how good our fasting is. You know, subhanAllah, when iftar comes, we have a huge buffet. Right? We eat till we can't move. And when Taraweeh comes, you know, there's a joke amongst the Imams. Right? Let me tell you this. There's a joke amongst the Imams that when we stand here, all we hear at the back is people burping. Right? And we, subhanAllah, because of the pressure of Taraweeh, we don't eat. And all we hear are people burping. SubhanAllah. Right? So we shouldn't be like this. When Ramadan comes, and when obviously it's a long day, and it's extremely hot, and we're extremely hungry, iftar comes, you know, we think with our stomachs, we don't think with our mind, right? And because of that, we obey the stomach, we don't obey the mind, and we eat. And when Taraweeh, we're standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are dozing off, because we don't know what the Imam is saying. He's just, you know, gibbering a few Arabic words, astaghfirullah, right, from the Quran. He's saying a few things very, very quickly, and all we're doing is looking at the time. If he goes beyond 59 minutes, then he's gonna get it, right? This should not be our attitude to Ramadan. Unfortunately, this is our attitude to Ramadan. That we, when Ramadan comes, we have a connection with the Quran. When Ramadan goes, that connection is gone. Remember, dear brothers, don't make Ramadan a means of a temporary connection with the Quran. Make Ramadan a permanent connection with the Quran. Right? Don't be from those people who abandon the Quran. And this is why in Surah Al-Furqan, in the opening verses of the 19th Juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he quotes the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who he is going to say on the day of Qiyamah to Allah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, Allah says, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّي إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will actually complain about these people on the day of Qiyamah. He will say that, oh my Lord, you revealed this Quran and we gave it so much importance, you gave it so much importance, so much virtue. However, my people have taken this Quran as something which has been abandoned by its people. Right? Do not be of these people. That when Ramadan comes, all we're thinking about is when will Eid come. You know, subhanAllah, some people before even Ramadan starts, they talk about Eid. It's like the only relevance that Ramadan has with their lives is Eid, is because of Eid. You know, subhanAllah, yes, Eid is a day of celebration, but the main celebration is celebrating the forgiveness of Allah in these 30 days. Dear brothers, Allah has given us another beautiful opportunity. So many people who used to live, you know, last year, last Ramadan they were alive. How many of those people are alive today? So many people have passed away. Just today we heard about the boxer who passed away, Muhammad Ali. Right? SubhanAllah, only a couple of days before Ramadan, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not will that he sees another Ramadan. We could be in that situation as well. We don't know who in this room is going to die tomorrow. We do not know that this Ramadan that we are going to witness, whether we'll see Eid. We do not know whether we are going to see another Ramadan. This Ramadan, treat it like your last Ramadan. And if you do that, dear brothers, what will happen? You will benefit from this Ramadan. At the end of Ramadan, you will succeed. And you'll be ready to take on the dunya. You'll be ready to take on the shayateen. We all know the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when Ramadan enters, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Suffidati shayateen. That the shayateen, they have been shackled, they have been chained. See, Allah has made things so easy for us. And still we find so many people sinning in the month of Ramadan. Now some people have this very famous question, that why is it that we still feel like sinning even though shaitan is locked up? Right? Good question, right? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, authentic hadith in Muslim. Right? Prophet sallallahu said that the shayateen have been chained. So why is it that we feel like doing sin? You see, dear brothers, us doing sin is not only about shaitan. Allah in the Quran, he talks about shaitan on the day of Qiyamah. What is he going to say to Allah? What is he going to say to man? He's going to say, Allah mentions that وَقَالَ الشَّيْطَانُ لَمَّا قُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَعَدَكُمْ وَعْدَ الْحَقِّ وَوَعَدْتُكُمْ فَأَخْلَفْتُكُمْ وَمَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ إِلَّا أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ لِي. Shaitan on the day of Qiyamah, he will say that do not blame me, blame yourselves. When, you know, astaghfirullah, may Allah save us. When a person, a Muslim, he is being doomed to hellfire, he will start blaming shaitan. The kuffar, the disbelievers, they will start blaming shaitan. Shaitan say, don't blame me. All I did, da'awtukum. I just invited you. I sent you an invitation card. You had a choice to answer this invitation card or reject this invitation. But what did we do? We answered the call of shaitan. We don't answer the call of Allah, we answer the call of shaitan. And because of this, what happens? This soul becomes corrupt. And when this soul becomes corrupt, even though shaitan may be locked away, even then what will happen? We will still be, you know, we'll have this corrupt soul that is constantly pulling us towards sin. Because you know the nature of the soul, dear brothers, is that it is always calling towards evil. That's why Allah in the opening verses of Surah Yusuf, or in the 13th juz, but it is in Surah Yusuf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءٍ. That the nafs, the soul, the nature of the soul is that it constantly commands towards evil. So what do we need to do? We need to put a barrier between us and shaitan. And thereafter, we need to train our souls. We need to strengthen our souls. And this is why we fast. Why do we abandon food and drink? You know, the scholars, they talk about food and drink and they say that one of the signs of a pious person, a zahid, a person who has abandoned this dunya, is that he will eat less and he will drink less. Why? Because when we do this, dear brothers, what does it do to the soul? It weakens the evil side of the soul, and the angelic side, it gets stronger. The food, the petrol of the evil side of the soul is food and drink. And the petrol, the food of the spiritual side, the angelic side, is dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more dhikr we do, the stronger our angelic side will be. You know, there's a constant battle between, you know, our soul is split up into two. We have one half which is constantly commanding towards this evil. And we have another half which is constantly pulling us towards goodness. And what happens, because we are always disobeying Allah, the more we disobey Allah, the more sin we do, then this angelic side will become weaker and weaker and weaker until it ceases to exist. It ceases to exist. Now, another thing, dear brothers, is why is it that we have to fast? Why is it that fasting is a means of taqwa in the first place? Why can't it be that taraweeh is a means of taqwa? Or doing dhikr of Allah is a means of taqwa? Why does it have to be fasting? Why only that act of worship? The reason being, dear brothers, is that when we fast, we abstain from things which are halal. We abstain from things which are halal, normally halal. It is permissible for us to drink water. It is permissible for us to consume halal meat. It is permissible to engage in relationship with our wives. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when you fast, you're not allowed to do any of these things. The reason being, again, Allah is giving us a message. Allah is giving us a message. And what's that message? That message is that you have proved to yourself in these 30 days that you can stay away from halal things. So why can't you stay away from haram things? Can you see? Right? You've proved to yourself that you stay away from halal things. Things which are habitual. You have a habit. People have a complaint that, you know, I've got an evil habit. It's become part of me. I can't live without it. Can you live without food and water? Can you live without food and water? The very fact that Allah is testing you with that sin is a proof that you can overcome that sin. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah will never ever burden a soul with more than what it can bear. The very fact, dear brothers, that Ramadan is coming and Allah is giving us another opportunity is a sign that Allah loves each and every single one of us sitting here. Allah wants us, you know, don't ever think, dear brothers, that Allah, you know, He is a very angry, you know, God, and He wants us to, He's just waiting for us to punish us. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions, he quotes Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that my mercy overcomes my anger. My mercy has overcome my anger. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is such, dear brothers, that He is waiting for us. He is waiting for us. That when will my servant return back to me? When will my servant come back to me? When will he change his ways? So dear brothers, the month of Ramadan is here. We need to, you know, think about how we're going to spend this month of Ramadan. We need to make sure we do not waste our time. You know, and the best thing to do, dear brothers, the best advice I can give you is that you need to make a timetable, right? What time you're going to wake up, what time you're going to go to work, what time you're going to come back from work, what are you going to do after you come back from work? Half an hour I'm going to sleep, half an hour I'm going to do this, 1 hour I'm going to do this. When you do this, you'll be organized. When you are organized, that's when you'll be able to look after your time. If you don't look after your time, dear brothers, just like every Ramadan has gone past, Ramadan will enter and it will go very, very quickly. Right? Ramadan will enter and it will go very, very quickly. So dear brothers, you know, Ramadan is a perfect opportunity to connect ourselves with the Quran, to gain taqwa, and wallahi, so many problems, so many issues we have in our lives, it will be solved. Once we have taqwa, it will be solved. Why? Because Allah in Surah Al-Talaq says, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. That whosoever is conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will give him a way out of his problems. You're worried about your rizq, وَيَرَزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. Allah will give you rizq from wherever, from places you can't even imagine. This is the benefits of taqwa. So dear brothers, how can we gain full benefit from the Quran? Number one, we need to recite the Quran. Number two, we need to ponder over the Quran. Something very, very important. Reciting the Quran is one thing, pondering over the Quran is another thing. Pondering over the Quran meaning that you study the meaning of the Quran. You study the tafsir of the Quran. And when you do this, you ponder over it. How does this verse apply to me? So many beautiful messages Allah has given. I've only shared with you, you know, a few verses from the Quran. The Quran has thousands and thousands of verses of so many different, you know, advices to man. It's for our benefit. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, He actually rebukes those people who don't ponder over the Quran. He says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Allah says, why do they not ponder over the Quran? Or is it that they have locks upon their hearts? Again, can you see? It's to do with the hearts. Whenever Allah talks about the Quran, it's to do with the hearts. The famous verse, the ending of Surah Al-Hashr, لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَىٰ جَبَلْ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِّنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. Allah says that if we were to reveal this Quran upon a mountain, that mountain would shake and tremble and it will shatter out of the fear of Allah. Why is Allah mentioning this? Allah is saying to us again that if it can break mountains, why doesn't it break your heart? In a good way. Why doesn't it break your heart? And when our hearts become humble, when our hearts become soft, dear brothers, wallahi, the effects will be amazing. When we stand in salah, you won't understand what the imam is reciting. You won't understand what the imam is reciting. But you hear Jahannam, you hear Jannah, you hear that Allah is Rahim, Allah is Rahman, and you will cry because of the sheer mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will hear Yawm al-Qiyamah, you will start shaking. That what is going to happen to me when I face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So dear brothers, we need to make our timetables. Everyone go do this before Ramadan starts. When you go home today, make your timetable. You start work at 9 a.m. I wake up at 7. Wake up slightly earlier. Start the day off with Quran. End the day with Quran. You're going to be ending the day with Quran anyway by coming to the masjid, listening to the imam. But we should all make an intention that I want to finish at least one khatam of the Quran. The purpose is not the khatam itself. Obviously, there's individual virtues with regards to the one who completes the Quran. But that's not the purpose. The purpose is not just to complete the Quran. The purpose is I'm going through this journey through the Quran with the intention that when Ramadan finishes, that's when the real test begins. When shaitan are coming full force, you know, they've been locked away for a long, long time. 30 days is a long time for shaitan. So they're raging with anger, right? As soon as the day of Eid comes, or the moon has been sighted, or in this case, we hear the announcement from Saudi, right, that the moon has been sighted. Eid has started, Eid Mubarak, we get all the texts, everyone's happy. You know, subhanAllah, what happens? Shaitan comes charging at us. That how can I make that Muslim, that believer in Allah, spoil his entire Ramadan in a single night? This is his first mission. When shaitan is released, this is his first mission. I want to make each and every single believer spoil his entire Ramadan The entire Ramadan will go down the drain, of no use whatsoever. All those hot days we used to fast. He'll make you put all his effort in washing that away in a single night by inviting us to sin again. The doors of sin will open. And you know, we see the beauty of Ramadan, the mercy that Allah has put in the month of Ramadan, that as soon as the month of Ramadan has been announced, the masjid is populated, right? The masjid is populated, right? Taraweeh is like Jumu'ah. Dhuhr Salah is like Jumu'ah. Every Salah is like Jumu'ah. And Jumu'ah is like amazing, right? Let's not even go there. This is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah is giving each and every single one of us who is sitting here, and each and every single one of us who is around this area, who unfortunately, they don't come to the masjid, they don't pray the salah. But when Ramadan comes, they get excited. They have that passion that I need to change my ways. We all have a noble intention. So many people have this noble intention that, you know, Ramadan comes, we want to get closer to Allah, I want to do this. So many objectives, we make our timetable, we do all of this. But you know, the first 10 days is normally where everyone's on this power, 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 yeah? We all come here, we're like powerhouses. And we burn ourselves out in 10 days. And the rest of the 20 days, we're just coming, yeah, whatever. I can't wait till Eid now. Right, so we shouldn't become like these people. So message today here, dear brothers, is even though it is going to be hot, we need to remember the first point I mentioned about Ramadan, the nature of the word itself is that it burns away our sins. So when we are burning in the sun, remember this point, and this will give you some hope, and this will quench your thirst. Okay, and you know there is one incident of Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. He mentions that we were with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam whilst we were traveling, and it was so hot that we used to place our hands on our foreheads and we used to wipe our sweat away. This is how hot it was. They were traveling in the middle of a desert in the Arabian Peninsula, the Arabian heat. And then he says that وَمَا فِينَا صَائِمٌ إِلَّا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. That none of us were fasting apart from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there was one other person, guess who? Nope. Abdullah ibn Rawaha radiallahu anhu. Some of you probably thinking, who the heck is he? Right? Abdullah ibn Rawaha, this is one of his qualities, that he used to fast purposely. He used to look for the days where it is hot. When it is hot, he used to fast. This used to be his iman. And this used to be, you know, he used to match the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this respect. They used to be there together. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is fasting. Abdullah ibn Rawaha is fasting as well. So dear brothers, do not think that, you know, it's so hot, how are we going to fast? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every year he makes it easy for us. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, whosoever fasts, one single fast for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will distance his face by 70 years from the hellfire. 70 years, one day. And how many days we fast? 29, 30 days. Subhanallah. So how many years is that, dear brothers? You do the maths. Go home and do the maths. Okay? Yeah, what? Loads, yeah? It's a lot of years, yeah. Subhanallah, right? So we'll be very, very far away from Jahannam. But dear brothers, this is only the case if we fully benefit from Ramadan. So along with fasting and reciting the Quran, we also need to, you know, do our dhikr, wherein we are doing istighfar, saying astaghfirullah continuously, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. And don't just become like a robot and just say astaghfirullah, 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 no. Say astaghfirullah. My teacher says that whenever you say astaghfirullah, you should think about one sin that you committed. And say astaghfirullah for that action. Astaghfirullah for that action. And not just istighfar, we need to do tawbah as well. What is tawbah? Tawbah is making a firm intention never ever to return to that sin again. The word tawbah comes from taba yatubu, which means to make a U-turn. We are heading towards Jahannam, we make a U-turn round the roundabout back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what tawbah is. Right? After doing our dhikr, we need to engage in dua. Make dua for the ummah. Make dua for yourselves, for your families, for all those people suffering around the world, for the deceased, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them and grants them Jannah. And when we do all of these actions, dear brothers, we will gain the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanAllah, what more do you want? If you got the forgiveness of Allah by the end of Ramadan, you have succeeded in this life and in the life hereafter. Another action which is neglected is spending for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is narrated about him that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was extremely generous. But when he came to Ramadan, he used to give away everything that he had. That's how generous he used to become in Ramadan. And you will see all the charities, you know, they plan for Ramadan like crazy. That how are we going to, you know, this scheme, that project and that project. And subhanAllah, some people curse this and some people say they're wasting their time. No, they are giving you the opportunity to gain ajr. They are giving you the opportunity to follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Ramadan. So let's take benefit from this and let's spend as much as we can. The wealth that Allah has given us is not our wealth. It is given to Allah by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us. So let's spend that wealth. And dear brothers, when we do this, inshallah, we'll get closer to Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all the ability to make the most of Ramadan and, you know, look out tomorrow. This time will be, inshallah, preparing for Taraweeh. I've got big feelings, okay? So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, to accept our Ramadan, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all our sins, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants us the ability to take full benefit from the month of Ramadan.